let's talk about simple distributed loads. As a very general and simple example, imagine you're in your room and you see your bookshelf. Here, we have our very expensive textbooks all lined up nicely. If we were to figure out a moment created about a point on this shelf or a force at a certain point, it would be hard to do since the weight created by the books is distributed across the whole shelf, hence the name, a distributed load. So what we need to do is be able to represent a distributed load as a resultant force. Removing the books, we see a graph which represents the load. We can represent this graph with an equation. We will label it W. To find the resultant force, all we need to do is find the area under the graph. In other words, integrate it. The lower bound is where the distributed load starts from, and the upper bound is where it ends. Finding just the resultant force isn't enough. We also need to know where to place it at. To do that, we use this equation. The x bar tells us the geometric center of the area under the distributed load, which is where we place our resultant force. Here, x represents the variable in our equation. This part is the equation of our curve, and the bottom is the same integral we used before. In other words, it's the area under the graph. Now, if the distributed load is simple, for example, made of rectangles and triangles, you don't have to integrate. Instead, simply find the area under the graph by multiplying length by height, or using the appropriate equation for an area of a triangle. We then place the individual resultant forces at the centroid of each piece. For a rectangle, that's simply the midpoint. For a right-angled triangle, it's 1/3 the length of the base. If the question asks for the resultant force at a certain point, for example at point A, then we just add up all the individual resultant forces. The moments about that point are also found by multiplying each individual resultant force by the perpendicular distance. Sometimes, however, we need to place our resultant force at a location so that it accounts for the moment as well. For example, let's assume our individual resultant forces created a total moment of 20 Newton meters about point A and our resultant force was 4 Newtons. Then all we need to do is place our resultant force 5 meters away from point A, which would then account for the total moment since it's force times perpendicular distance. You will understand this much better with examples, so let's get started. The first two examples will be simple shapes and the last two will be with integrals. Let's take a look at this problem where we have to find an equivalent resultant force and find its location measured from point O. Notice how the 4 kN per meter load is a square and the 6 kN per meter load is a triangle. Since these are basic shapes, we don't need to integrate to find our answer. We just need to figure out the area of each load. Let's start with the square-shaped load. All we do is multiply the length by the load. We place this force at the midpoint of its length, which is 1 meter away from point O. Next, we look at the triangle piece. So remember, we find the area of a triangle by multiplying half times base times height. To place this force, we need to figure out the centroid location, which would be 1/3 the length of the base, so that's 0.5 meters. The total distance from point O would then be 2 meters plus 0.5 meters, giving us 2.5 meters. The total resultant force for both pieces is simply the addition of the two values we found. Now we need a place to put this resultant force. Since we aren't going to show the resultant force at point O, we actually need to place it somewhere that accounts for each individual moment created by the individual resultant forces. To do that, we need to sum the moments about point O. Let's assume clockwise moments to be positive. So for the rectangle, we have force F1, which is the force we found for the rectangular piece, times the distance from point O. Next, we have the triangle resultant force, and the distance from point O is 2.5 meters. The total moment created by the two forces would be the addition of these two values. So again, the two individual resultant forces would create a total moment of 19.25 kN meters about point O. Since we're going to show a single resultant force, we have to make sure our resultant force is placed at a certain location that would give us the same exact moment as did the individual resultant forces. So where can we place it? Well, let's assume that we place the resultant force a distance of d away from point O. To find it, all we need to do is equal the resultant force times d to the total moment. This value we just found tells us that if we place our resultant force 1.54 meters away from point O, it'll create the same moment as did the other two forces. So now, we represented the distributed load as a single resultant force, which accounts for all the forces. Let's take a look at this problem where we have to find an equivalent resultant force and a couple moment about point A. So unlike the previous question, we're going to show both the resultant force and the moment at point A. Now if we look at this distributed load, we can see that it's actually made up of a triangular piece and a rectangular piece. Let's start with the triangular piece. This part is 1 kN per meter and the length is 1.8 meters. The location of this force would be 1/3 the length of the base. Next, we have the bottom rectangular piece. The location of this force would be at the midpoint of the length. Next, we have the area of this rectangle. Again, it would be placed at the midpoint of the length. Now to find the equivalent resultant force of all of these forces, we just need to add it all up. But notice how the two forces here is at an angle of 60 degrees. That means we need to break them into components. For force 2, it only has a y component. Now let's add up the x components and the y components. We just found the components of our resultant force. So now we have to find the magnitude. Just the magnitude isn't enough. We also need to show an angle. So let's draw the components of our resultant force and use the inverse of tan to find it. We found our resultant force, so now we need to find an equivalent couple moment about point A. We will assume clockwise moments to be positive. Let's start with the triangle force. The perpendicular distance from point A is 0.6 meters. Next, we have the moment for the rectangular piece. Lastly, we have the moment created at the top. Note that the perpendicular distance for this force is the cosine of the slanted piece plus the 0.6 meters. The resultant moment is the addition of all of these values. With this, we can replace all the forces with a single resultant force and a couple moment at point A. Now we're going to look at an example where the distributed load is shown to us with an equation. In a problem like this, the resultant force is the integral of the equation given to us. The lower bound would be where the distributed force starts, which is at 0 meters, and the upper bound is where it ends, and that's 3 meters. Solving the integral gives us the resultant force, and since the distributed force was downwards, our resultant force is also downwards. Now we need to find where our resultant force is going to be placed. So we have to use the equation I mentioned before. On top, we have x times the equation given for the distributed load. The upper and lower bounds are the same. On the bottom, we have the same integral as before, which is the resultant force. Solving gives us 2.4 meters. So this value we got is measured from the w-axis, in other words, the left side, and that's where we place our resultant force. The question asks us to find the moment about point O, which means we need the distance from point O to the resultant force, and that's 0.6 meters. Now we can find the moment by multiplying the distance by the resultant force. If the bar was able to move freely, then the resultant force would create a counterclockwise movement, so our moment is counterclockwise. This tells us the moment created about point O from the distributed load. Let's take a look at one last example where we need to represent the distributed load as a single resultant force. So as with the previous question, we start off with an integral to find the resultant force. The lower bound starts at 0 meters and the upper bound is 6 meters. Solving gives us the resultant force, which is downwards, since our distributed load was also downwards. Next, we need to find the location where we place our resultant force. For that, we use this equation. Solving gives us our answer. This answer tells us where to place our resultant force, which would represent the distributed load. That should cover the types of problems you will face when it comes to simple distributed loads. I hope this video helped, and if it did, please consider sharing it with your friends and classmates. They too might find it helpful. Thanks for watching, and best of luck with your studies.